Jimmy Page, it's lovely to have you back on Planet Rock.
Yeah, thanks, Liz. It's always a pleasure to do your show. It really is.
It's wonderful because you were quiet for a long, long time, and it's lovely to have you back doing lots of stuff, not just the Zeppelin stuff.
Well, no, I think, you know, because the one thing about things is that you need to be seen to be playing live. So if that's not the case, people don't know what you're doing. And quite clearly, I've been involved in a lot of stuff along the way. Like I've been involved in doing a website that looped with a different sort of homepage every day. That was quite an epic thing. I was involved with doing the celebration day, the Yardbirds, really, the Led Zeppelin O2 show, and I was involved in doing the re-releases of the Led Zeppelin catalogue with these companion discs, and doing the promo for that, so that people understood what it was that was coming, as opposed to thinking maybe it's a couple of bonus tracks. I did the book some time back, although we're here, I know, to talk about the book, and it was done on a sort of very high-end edition with Genesis Books, and there was a complete run of like 2,500, and they sold out pre-publication date, and that's quite a while back. That's a few years back, and I was really keen to have it just as you see in front of you, the equivalent of a Waterstones book, something that I didn't want to have a digital book. No, it needed to be something that's really tactile. So it's in the tradition of, like, you know, vinyl albums and, you know, books that we love to go to bookshops and browse. It's all part of that. And all of these projects have taken time, but from my perspective, they're all important. One's as important as the next.
This is incredible. I mean, if we had 3 hours together, there wouldn't be enough time for you and I to browse through this book.
But even
though it's, I know I've heard a few people. I was at Olympic Studios on Tuesday, at the playback for Zep4 and Houses, which is amazing. But I know I've heard a few people sort of say, oh, but it's a pictorial autobiography. But to me, that's actually more interesting.
Well, it is, because people don't, you see. They may say that, but from my point of view, if somebody has a... I know I do this, I've done this all the time, and I guarantee that people listening have done the same thing too. When somebody has an autobiography, or there's a biography out of somebody they really like, first thing they do is start looking at the pictures.
See what the pictures are.
And I mean, I always have. And it is that old adage that every picture tells a story. And so I wanted to put a photographic documentary together to make an autobiography in photographs that starts when I'm like 13. I am playing the guitar at that point, and it goes, I'm a 12 or 13 in the first shot, and it goes all the way through to literally this year, because it's got the Berklee College and the where I get an honorary doctorate for music, and I mean, that's so cool, because in between being the choir boy and in between that, there's just a complete tableau of images and a myriad of sort of personalities. And it's like chameleon roles, really.
And I think also, I mean, as you can see, I've got a million yellow stickies in here, because I was going to sort of say, but you know, if we have time, we will. But lots of people... You know, if I said Jimmy Page to anybody walking down the street, they'd probably say, you know, a visual image of you. It would be dragon suit, double
fantastic
neck guitar.
Yeah.
But what's wonderful is that we start at the beginning here with you as a choir boy, which no one's ever seen you as a choir boy.
Not as a choir boy, no. Actually, that wasn't, you know, the stage clothes of the time were supplied by the church. However, I was pretty conscious about how I looked, and the image of what I wanted to put across, and the persona of that was really important. And I can see what I'm doing is I'm changing that relative to various roles. And as you say, it arrives through to areas of the dragon suit where it's really totally custom made.
Yeah.
And whereas in the early days, it's sort of slung together with things in second-hand shops and that. But nevertheless, it's the attitude that shines through these
yeah.
clothes, really.
100%. Yeah. I mean, as well as it being...
Well, people know that. They do it themselves, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, and as well as it being all about the music, you obviously have always... You've always looked really good. I don't know how else to say that, but you
Thank
have
you.
Always looked really good. You've always had a style and a way of carrying yourself and a way of presenting yourself, which, you know, obviously you probably didn't style yourself as a choir boy. But not that one. But do you know, like, right from, you know, the fabulous pictures in when you were doing the sessions, the great pictures at the early days of the Yardbirds. That's even before we get to Zeppelin. And there's lovely stuff in here that you would never see anywhere, like pictures of you with Brian Jones.
Yes.
That's, you know.
Yeah, no, it's magical, isn't it?
Yeah,
it really, really is.
Wonderful photos.
And Ian Stewart took those photographs.
Right, okay.
And the weird thing about those photographs is they're like double exposures of jazz artists that he's got.
Yeah.
That Stu took photographs of them, and they're like double exposures, and they're really weird.
Yeah.
But they're good and they're cool. The thing about it is that, post the Guava Boy, there's still like, I'm still sort of image conscious within the day. So there's sort of photographs from 1959 there, and 1958, 1959. And you see the decades roll by and the fashions change, and this young kid just starts to get older and more mature and, you know, more confident in every respect. And the presentation of what I can do is it's in an area of expansion. And of course, it's not so bad in the times of the Yardbirds. Once it comes to Led Zeppelin and you've got four equally talented musicians, that they're all master musicians in their own right, that everybody who's involved in Led Zeppelin, their own personal performance just zooms up into the stratosphere, each and every one of us. And you can tell it on like the first album. You can't you can't imagine that I'd actually played like lots of pretty good guitar, what was pretty good during the days of the Yardbirds. But let me tell you, on that first album, I never played guitar like that beforehand. John Bonham had never played trance because he hadn't had the opportunity to flex his musical muscles. John Paul Jones, none of us. We just went into the stratosphere with that. But in the book, it shows pictures of the house that I had at Pangbourne, which is where...
That was the one by the river?
Yes, by the river in Berkshire, Pangbourne, Berkshire. And this is where the group were actually rehearsed towards the first album and the set that we were going to do when we went out there. Because I was more than keen to go out and actually play with this band in front of audiences to try this new material before recording it. So, in other words, you'd gone in with a baptism of fire with this material. You couldn't do it now. You couldn't do it. YouTube would confound you. But in those days, it would do. But in those days, it was the right thing to do. So I did. It shows that room where all of that was accomplished, and then it's the same room that A Whole Lot of Love is routined with the rest of the band, and What Is and What Should Never Be, and.
It
yeah,
really
it's
is
quite a magical house, really.
It's such a wonderful window on your world, really.
Yeah,
that's the best way I can describe it as a fan.
Yeah.
But how? I don't even want to ask you how long it took you to choose all the never mind choose the photos, the ones that you probably had to leave out. But it must have been a seriously painstaking process to put this together.
Well, I was told that if I'd have done a written book, I'd say, "What's the sort of time estimate on something like that?" And they said 2 years, and I thought, and the rest by the time there's lawyers clambering all over you. So this took like less time than that.
Right.
But it was sort of drawn out over a period where some work was done on it, and then other things came up, and then returning to it. It was the way that I remembered sort of doing photo sessions and seeing contact sheets, that had all changed, because now the photographers have put the their images in with agencies, and they go, yeah, well, I know those images, everyone's seen those, but I want to get back to the contact sheets. And so sometimes it took longer, where you had to get hold of the photographers and see just how cooperative they would be under the circumstances. But I had a lot of the material, well, not, you know, a percentage of the material myself. So that's how I knew I could do it starting right from the beginning and going through the very early stages of being in a group as a kid, still being at school, right through to the end, you know.
I'm just the reason I've got all these little yellow things in here is because I'm going to just pick one.
Go on then.
And then you can tell me about it. It's just at random, so I have no idea which one it's going to be. These are just some of my favourites, right? So I'm just going to open it.
All right.
Ah, okay. Ah, so I love this photo.
That's a really interesting one.
I love that.
Because
picture.
I'm actually standing on the wing of a plane.
But you look like you're having loads of fun.
Well, I am. And yeah.
Was this the firm? Ish time.
What time? Yeah. Well, yeah. It's got the.
Did you
visa.
Keep these?
Well, they're my passports.
Do you have like a shoebox under your bed with these?
They're not quite in a shoebox, but I actually a couple of passports got ripped off, but it didn't matter because I had enough to be able to complete the journey going all the way through from the first passport stamp when I was a studio musician, all the way through, and certain travels that I made to Egypt and Cambodia and all that. That's all sort of covered in here as well.
What made you get on the wing of a plane?
I just thought it was fun. Am I holding a drink in my hand there? It looks like it.
Possibly. Well, I don't want to end, Jimmy, but I think we may have to, because otherwise I'll make you go through the whole book.
Well, do another one. Come on, let's do another one.
All right, let's do one more. Okay, this is an earlier one. Okay, this is one of my... I love this photo. That's the Bronwyr one, right?
It is Bronwyr.
You don't often see Jimmy Page in wellies and a fishing hat.
No, but that's, curiously enough, that's the same outfit there. Not the wellies, but the jeans and that overcoat and the hat. I'm going to wear at Bath.
Is it? Oh, that was the next thing I was going to ask you.
I was quite consistent with my clothes, really. Yeah. So, but that, yeah, that's down in the stream by Bronwyr Cottage after a walk. Yeah, I'm in good shape there.
Yeah, you look pretty good.
Yeah, having a good time.
Well, no wonder you're making Led Zeppelin 3.
That's right. That's right. Actually, it was not only that, it was the first break from 1968 on. You know, that was the first proper break because we've been going to America on every available opportunity.
And
we've been touring and making records and Led Zeppelin 2. And that had come out. We're at the process now of considering Led Zeppelin 3.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I'm at the cottage here. I've got my sort of family of the time, and Robert's there with his family.
And
we're about to start doing things that end up like That's the Way is one of the key songs that comes from that particular period.
Jimmy, we're going to reconvene in a couple of weeks to talk about Led Zeppelin 4 and House of the Holy, so I'm going to let you go.
Good.
But it's been a pleasure as always.
Well, that's a real pleasure too.
And Jimmy Page by Jimmy Page is just the most awesome book.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Yeah, I hope people enjoy it. I know they will.